This is really the most exciting place, if you've got a soul, that is, a most exciting place to live. This is the greatest and most dynamic place in the whole of Europe, in my opinion.
The end of the Second World War found the people and the city of Birmingham in good heart, but in pretty bad shape. Despite this, Birmingham's post-war reconstruction plans, particularly those for slum clearance and roads, were much more ambitious than those for other cities. But money was tight. Post-war government policy was to clamp down on local authority spending, so the early initiatives evaporated, taking with them some of the harmony and pulling together that had emerged during the war. The story then of Birmingham's next 30 years is not so much a tale of achievement as a journey down a long, hard road, trying to catch up after the stagnation of the war years. On the face of it, the city seemed to return to normal quite quickly. The larger gaps in the building line were hidden behind hoardings and remaining bomb sites taken over by SPIVs selling second-hand cars. City centre shops were open, but there were shortages and queues everywhere.
We got away from the restrictions of military life, but we found we'd run into a whole set of new restrictions with the necessity for a ration card and an identity card and clothing coupons, and a flourishing black market, of course. If you wanted to buy clothing coupons, you could. You only had to go into the nearest pub and somebody was there trying to sell a few.
Royal visits were even then a popular gesture guaranteed to raise flagging spirits. And in the immediate post-war years, the King and Queen were often in Birmingham to exchange gifts and honour the city that had sacrificed so much during the 6 years of war. In the festival year of 1951, a young Princess Elizabeth came to unveil the statue of Queen Victoria, newly cast in bronze. A symbol of rebirth. It was also a timely reminder of the pioneer days when Birmingham Corporation was setting the pace for the rest of Britain. But 70 years after Joseph Chamberlain had been Lord Mayor, many of the evils he had condemned then still existed, and even the welfare state was making little headway.
The wealthy country and the slums. All the millions of money and all the millions of our countrymen that still live in this. All this was supposed to go after the last war, but this little world is still with us in every big city, where the citizens of tomorrow play in filth in their inherited nursery, the gutter.
In Birmingham's central areas, 100,000 still lived in appalling conditions. 81,000 homes had no baths, 35,000 shared toilets, and there were still 29,000 back-to-backs. Overcrowding was severe. Workshops and factories loomed over houses. Light and air were replaced with noise and smoke.
Birmingham had large-scale plans for redevelopment before the Second World War, but when the Town and Country Planning Act was passed in 1944, Birmingham very quickly took advantage of the new provisions there for compulsory purchase and so on. And in 1945, it drew up plans for five comprehensive development areas, which more or less totally ringed the city centre. And they were all mainly mixed residential industrial areas. Comprehensive demolition was carried out and rebuilding of a kind which I suppose was the conventional town planning wisdom at that time. A mixture of high-rise blocks, low-rise blocks of houses and maisonettes, industry segregated out and put elsewhere, lots of public open space which wasn't in the form of gardens but more or less parkland flowing between the buildings, And despite what many people think about high-rise development, a very, very low density.
Birmingham's first flats had been tenements in Milk Street, Digbeth, built in 1898. An isolated example at the time, the experiment wasn't repeated until 1925, with these three-storey blocks in Garrison Lane, Bordesley Green. A competition produced the Emily Street flats at Highgate in 1939. They found little favour with a Mr. Dugmore.
I've been living here 2.5 years, and I'd very much like to meet the architect. For this reason, whoever persuaded him to build these places of the material he has, well, I'm not quite sure what was in their minds. It's sound enough. It's too sound, as a matter of fact, because the place rings like a bell.
The council pressed on with plans for 5 comprehensive development areas. And however we judge their efforts today, public servants like Herbert Manzoni, the city surveyor, and Frank Price in the Public Works Department saw the rebuilding of their city in much the same light as their Victorian predecessors.
Now, this is the land I was telling you about, upon which the school is to be built. It'll be built in an undulating parkland. And I'm hoping, and I believe it will be true, that Birmingham will be one of the most beautiful cities in Europe when this redevelopment job is completed. Now, over here you can see some of the type of property in which I was born.
A city architect had been appointed in 1951, and he favoured mixed development at a much higher population density than had been seen before the war. It meant building many more high-rise flats, despite the results of surveys that showed Brummies didn't want to live in towers. The city's first tower blocks were built at Tile Cross in 1953 and others in the Nichols development area a year later.
Well, now, you live in a very high flat. How many stories up?
6.
Do you mind living so high?
No.
What do you like about your flat?
Well, it's all convenient, and the doctor said that I was to have a place on the level. I couldn't do the stairs, you know.
You've got a lift here.
We got a lift.
Mm. Well, it looks a very nice little flat to me. Anything you dislike about it?
I don't dislike anything about it. I like it all, and I've made myself comfortable, and I wouldn't like to go now.
Well, Christopher and David, how'd you like your new home?
Yes, thank you.
What do you particularly like about it?
Well, we don't have to boil every drop of water now, whereas in the old house we did. And another thing is that of a night time, we have a splendid view all over the city. It's all lit up.
That's a nice night, sir.
Yes, it is.
What about you, David?
Well, I like the fire because once you light it, it keeps in all the night and keeps it nice and warm. And also, we have a toilet to ourselves now, whereas in the other house, we had to share one and also walk across the yard.
Generally speaking, Birmingham's industry was in a poor state at the end of the war. Machinery had been overused and under-maintained, and while some large concerns had been strengthened by the demands of the war machine, it was only the traditional adaptability of many Birmingham firms that prevented more of the smaller ones going to the wall. Yet with export or die ringing in their ears, companies allied to the motor industry began to prosper, and even Birmingham's silver craftsmen were able to pick up where they'd left off. BSA workers put aside the rocket and Sten gun and began concentrating on motorbikes. And at Longbridge, the now colossal Austin Motor Company set to meet an international demand for all sorts of motor cars caused by 6 years enforced loss of production. By 1949, 84,000 Austin cars had been exported since the end of the war.
Some firms failed to adapt to these changing market conditions. Most, though, became more efficient, often by mergers or linking up across industries. The scarcity of skilled labour led to high wages and the rise in the power of the unions that was to become a key factor for Birmingham's industry.
You get a lot of people come back from the war that have been pushed around by a lot of people, whether they liked it or not. You got a different class of people in the card industry. How can I say? To get in the card industry before the war, if you applied for a job, they say, are you a skilled turner, a miller, or a skilled fitter? And you've got a job. Of course, the war brought diluted labour in, butchers, bakers, and things like this. So you had a bit of a breakdown. And then things started to move. People started to ask questions. Profit became a dirty word. And, you know, the trek up to Coughton Park to have the meetings became a recognised thing.
As early as 1938, 5,000 skilled workers at Coughton Park had downed tools for a week to secure parity with other shadow aero factories. And during the war, with joint production committees used as a first step to workers' control, there was a corresponding rise in the power of the shop steward.
In this period, what essentially happened in industrial relations was that an informal system grew up alongside the formal system. That the formal trade unions, the paid officials, the national executives, came less and less important in determining wage levels. There was high employment, high trade union membership, a period of affluence, of you've never had it so good. And in this period, the shop stewards gained quite a stranglehold on Birmingham industry. In Birmingham, the car industry led. The car industry was the one in which the workers were most strongly organised, most militant, and most effective at gaining their demands. But other workers in Birmingham used the success and the example of the car workers in order to gain their own advances, in order to bring their own wages in what was already quite a high wage city up to the level of the workers at the Austin.
Cadbury's, by contrast, had developed systems of management worker consultation long before the war, and works councils had been democratically elected at Bourneville since 1918. During the early post-war years, Cadbury's had been continually frustrated by a shortage of cocoa, but with the gradual relaxation of import controls, this obstacle had been removed by 1950, and the factory in a garden entered its most successful period since the early days of dairy milk. It was a success matched by a high profile in public relations, and it's unlikely that any factory in Britain entertained more visitors. Up till 1970, a year after the merger with Schweppes, as many as 100,000 people a year came by coach and special train to see round the factory. Council, meanwhile, was anxious to use its new airport, opened in 1939, and BEA's thrice-weekly Paris service, inaugurated on the 8th of April 1949, made regular domestic flights from Birmingham a real prospect. BEA effectively controlled all domestic scheduled services, and during 1950 started regular flights to Belfast and the Channel Islands. But the enthusiasm for these services in official quarters was not matched by the public's response, and international connections still had to be made by a shuttle flight to London. Even these were not that busy, and so in 1954, BEA hit on the idea of filling empty seats with schoolchildren. The flying classrooms, as they became known, captured the imagination of the national press. The Duchess of Kent, who had opened the first terminal, returned in 1961 to open a new international extension. By the early 1970s, the airport was beginning to profit from the holiday trade. The future seemed bright, even if the passenger facilities were still inadequate for an aspiring international airport. With a shortage of cars and little or no petrol for those lucky enough to have them, peacetime brought travellers flocking back to the railways. In the immediate post-war period, Snow Hill saw a massive increase in traffic, leading to a peak in 1960 when 130,000 trains moved 7.5 million people. But its days were numbered. The electrification of the Euston Line in March 1967 led to the closure of Snow Hill as a mainline station. New Street, on the other hand, though it was to lose the Queen's Hotel facade and much of its character, was to become, in the words of British Rail, the finest rail interchange centre in the country. Both stations are remembered with affection, but the nostalgia and the noise of steam couldn't hold out against the clean simplicity of electrification. Another sacrifice on the altar of efficiency was the tram car. Birmingham's trams had never been that threatened by suburban rail services, but had met their match in the bus. Although it was not until 1949 that the City Council was able to approve a firm programme for the converting of remaining routes to buses, some had begun to go from 1930. One of the first was the tram along the Hagley Road, where in these pictures of Five Ways Junction taken in the 1950s, the victory seems complete. Birmingham's last tram, specially painted for the occasion, ran from Steelhouse Lane to Short Heath and back on the 4th of July 1953. Part of the journey was in the hands of the Lord Mayor, James Crump, who had been a motorman on Birmingham's first overhead-powered electric tram half a century before. Number 616 returned in triumph to the Miller Street depot, passing yet another vanished landmark, the Ansell's Brewery in Aston. An era was over. The M1 motorway started snaking its way north towards the Midlands in the late 1950s. Birmingham was to become the centre of another national network. The pressure was on to improve not just the fabric of the city, but also its roads and services. The Inner Ring Road, described as a city street of novel character, was started in 1957. Birmingham was the first provincial city to adopt parking meters. Strange constructions like this bolt-together car park sprang up to cope with the increasing number of cars in the city. The developers of the Ringway also commissioned Birmingham's most famous landmark, the Rotunda. There was a novel answer to the problems of traffic flow at a major road junction. The solution was the Camp Hill flyover, a prefabricated structure put up over a long weekend. This was the first day of its estimated 20-year life, 26 years ago in 1962. The early 60s also saw some major city centre developments. One captured the imagination of the media and the general public, who saw it as fitting the then image of Birmingham as big, bold and brash. The Bullring Indoor Shopping Centre.
On a site of just under 4 acres, which has been Birmingham's traditional marketplace for centuries, they've just opened the Bullring Shopping Centre. You arrive undercover and you can do all your shopping sheltered from the elements in this multi-level, air-conditioned, £8 million development. It's the most advanced of its kind anywhere in the world. A housewife's paradise with everything from a market stall to a supermarket, and no streets to cross, no traffic to negotiate. Brum is setting the pace for the rest of the country. London and other cities are expected to follow her example with similar centres. Here's to its success.
Mistakes were certainly made in Birmingham, and many words written about the inhumanity of forcing pedestrians underground while cars travelled above. But if nothing else, by 1970, the city centre was without doubt the most modern in Britain. To go with the new face of Birmingham, an enduring symbol of the motor city, the Mini. It was the brainchild of Alec Izzigonis. It first appeared in 1959 and was to become the most famous small car in the world. Despite the success of the Mini, the demand for cars on the home market was uneven. Layoffs were common, so were strikes over pay and conditions in many parts of the motor industry. In those days, the car worker had a reputation for swinging the lead.
It was a piecework factory, and people were expected to work hard for the high level of wages, and they accepted that when they came into the factory. So, you know, I would need to run away from the idea that it was like a holiday camp. It wasn't at all. And certainly under the individual piecework system and the group piecework system that operated on tracks, there was a tremendous amount of incentive generated, and our people earned money. Indeed, every expansion that took place in Longbridge after the war, they raided Birmingham and the Black Country for all its skilled labour.
It was a production race, that if you had any problems on the production line, you just bought off problems. You just offered the workers a few extra pence, a few extra shillings, as it would be at the time, hoping that that would improve the industrial relations. Of course, it didn't really improve the industrial relations at all. It just swept the problems under the carpet.
Oh, that it's been described as the days of wine and rises, when we would ask for a rise, management would whine, but then give it us. It was that simple in those days. That's not a case of condemning the unions for asking for an increase in money. It's condemning management for not having the moral fibre to say this is the way the company has got to be run. We have got to literally invest in our own future. They weren't doing this.
They also weren't listening to warnings from local manufacturers that industry in the area was becoming dangerously over-specialised. Adrian Cadbury was the chairman of the West Midlands Economic Planning Council in 1970.
What we saw was that this was the only region where more than half of the employed population was employed in manufacturing industry. Now, that wasn't all. It was also the fact that our manufacturing industry was terribly dependent on the metal-using trades, metal bashing, if you like, and particularly on the car industry. So what we were saying was that unless we had the opportunity within this region to develop, to innovate, to start new types of business, to expand here instead of being forced, if we wanted to grow, to move out of the region, then there were the seeds of very serious trouble ahead.
The end of the 60s saw a sharp rise in local unemployment. It rose above the national average for the first time. But local warnings that industry in the city was becoming dangerously over-specialised fell on deaf ears. The BSA company had always been a prime example of how Birmingham firms were flexible enough to adapt their products to changing demands. The firm's near bankruptcy should have rung warning bells. BSA had been on the slide for some time. In 1960, it had made record profits of £3.5 million. 10 years later, it was losing £8.5 million. There'd been some major blunders, but what killed it was a foolish contempt for the mass production methods of the Japanese. A breakdown of communication between the skilled men on the shop floor and a research team resulted in a bike only a 6'3" man could ride. The last straw came when BSA failed to supply any machines for the crucial 1971 selling season in the States. Production ceased in April 1972.
I think in some ways the West Midlands started going wrong very soon after the Second World War, because they really had a monopoly of the products they were making for so long. It was really a take-it-or-leave-it attitude, that they didn't mind there being long waiting lists and so on. And over time, the control of industrial relations, the control of costs, whether their prices were right, whether the quality was right, whether the delivery was right. In the 1950s, even in the 1950s, this started to go wrong.
If we had had continuity of production in this country, if we had not had all the industrial disputes, there would have been no problem with British Leyland, and we would have had the money to invest in a new Mini and in the other cars as well.
In the late 1960s, it was pretty evident that the state of the British car industry was evidence of the British disease writ large, that the British car industry was increasingly uncompetitive, and that unless some really substantial changes were made in the way it was organised, we simply wouldn't be able to sell even in our own market, let alone in the foreign markets. Of course, cars had contributed massively to British exports. Accordingly, governments of both colours, Labour in the late 60s and the Conservatives in the early 70s, made real efforts to bring union power under control. Both of them at that stage were unsuccessful.
The Industrial Relations Bill, with cooling off periods and legally enforceable procedural agreements, found little favour with the shop stewards.
The organising theme of the legislation was to bring the militant shop stewards, the informal system of industrial relations, under control in the long term of the state, in the short term of the union bureaucracies. This was a very bad time to do it, at a time of great union militancy, and a time when the union leaderships were themselves inclining to the left. So to the Birmingham workers, the Industrial Relations Bill appeared to be an effort to bring under control, to take away from them what had brought them prosperity, growth, success.
There was growing discontent too from Birmingham's multi-storey flat dwellers in the new housing developments. Typical of these was the Castle Vale estate, built on the site of Birmingham's Castle Bromwich Aerodrome and housing 20,000 people in 5,000 homes. The complaints were many. No amenities, long distances to work, vandalism, and the uprooting of people to areas they hardly knew. The complaints were fuelled by a growing body of opinion which was worried by the social implications of high-rise living and unfavourable comparisons with the type of area they'd replaced.
There was a high density in the areas before. A lot of it was slums, admittedly. You had people living at about 200 people to the acre very often, if not more. But that density means that you can support lots of communal and social facilities. You can have corner shops, you can have pubs, you can have high streets of shops, industry mixed in close to where people are living and so on. And that creates a very easily sustainable social mixture. When you build again at half that density and you put all the shops into little shopping centres, which are quite a distance from a lot of the housing, you've got no provision for corner shops, very few pubs and so on, then immediately the social life, the quality of life in those areas goes down considerably.
A proliferation of anniversaries in the 1970s only served to remind people how much of the pioneering work had been done 100 years before. At the end of the swinging 60s, apart from being in the grip of the Hong Kong flu epidemic, Birmingham seemed to have lost its way. Its skilled craftsmen felt they were no longer appreciated, or in some cases even needed. British Leyland shares were dropping, and there were reports of the company linking up with the Japanese. But there were signs that even if the manufacturing base was heading for recession, the service and building industries were on the up and up. The Brindley Walk Restoration Project won a Civic Trust Award and refocused attention on the tourist potential of the city's canals. Not far away, the new Repertory Theatre with its monumental fly tower was rising from the mud of Broad Street. It was the realisation of another wartime dream and a personal triumph for Barry Jackson, the founder of Birmingham's old Rep. Next to the newly electrified London to Birmingham Railway, surveyors marked out Birmingham's £39 million National Exhibition Centre, which with all party support on the council and with government backing, was destined to become Britain's premier showcase. And then in 1972, the most dynamic image of the second city, the Gravelly Hill Interchange, better known throughout the country as Spaghetti Junction, was at last ready for its official opening.
My Lord Mayor, Lady Mayoress, your worships, ladies and gentlemen, this is perhaps the most exciting day in the history of the road system in this country, because in opening this Midland Link today, we are for the first time going to get the full benefit out of the first 1,000 miles of motorway that have been built in this country.
And so, by 1972, Birmingham was very firmly at another crossroads. The city would need all its innate resilience to bring it through the coming years of recession.